Good evening, everybody. I'd like to turn to the book of Galatians. We're going to look through a few things again tonight from that good letter. In my attic, there's a shoebox. Ever so often, as I'm climbing up in there to get into decorations or whatever is stored up there, and it's a mess, I see the shoebox. My mom's handwriting on the end of it. The box is very old, and it says, David's letters from Vietnam. She saved every one. They were a treasure for her. One time since I've gotten them back in my possession, I opened the box and looked at a couple things. Don't recall much about it. I just grabbed different ones at random just to see what I wrote. Kind of as I suspected, it wasn't really much. But she saved every one of those letters. And I suspect that someday, when I think I really have time, I'll sit down and actually assimilate them in order and try to remember what I was really thinking at the time. There are other people that have treasured letters and things in their possession of great-great-grandmothers that wrote to whoever, and it's something they save and hold back. And as I was going back through the reading of this letter here from Paul, I got to thinking about how special this must have been to those people when they got a letter from the Apostle Paul. Now, he'd been to this place and he'd done a lot of stuff in Galatia, and this letter was meant to be sent to several different churches in that area. But how neat that must have been. And then it hit me how much we ought to be appreciating this letter along with all the others that are there. That God is actually writing a letter not just for those people in mind, but he had us at Central, including our visitors and everybody else in mind as he wrote that letter. Think about that for just a second. Let it set in as we think about what Paul writes tonight. What I want to do is just kind of deal with a couple miscellaneous points. We talked about the gist of the letter the last couple weeks and some main points here. I just want to focus in on what I call highlights or special things that I see in the book of Galatians. In the first verse of Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, and maybe you already suspected if you read through the letter that he's likely to hone in on that. It's such a neat verse that Paul now is throwing out to us, writing to us, and he's telling us something about himself and how important his Christianity is. And he says these words, I have been crucified with Christ. Now that was a terrible, terrible, torturous thing going on in that day and time. To be crucified. I don't know, unless you maybe have seen the movie The Temptation, if you could imagine just how horrible it must have been. The pain that Jesus went through. And now Paul ties himself in with that and says, I've been crucified with Christ. And as he goes on, he says, and it's no longer I who live. Of course, obviously, he's still living, so he's not dead. But it's no longer I who live now, but it's Christ who lives in me. There's just this whole change in his life. When I read this verse and the rest of it here, let's read the rest and look at some things here. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life which I now live, in the flesh, of course, still, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and he gave himself for me. I think of at least four words when I think of that passage. Number one, sacrifice. Jesus sacrificed his life. Paul, before he was the Apostle Paul, was the one who persecuted the church in such a zealous way that he was off in other cities doing. You couldn't stop Paul except by a blinding light from the Lord. And everything's changed around. And what a change it was. What a sacrifice it was for him to make the changes that he did. But he says, I've been crucified with Christ. Now, I'm not torturing the church anymore. I'm with him. I'm with him to death. Sacrifice. And if you read through the book of Acts and you stop and try to really envision walking that journey. And we make missionary journeys today, but it's not in comparison to what Paul walked. We assess how much it's going to cost to fly in an airplane to go here and maybe stay in a hotel. If we really inconvenience ourselves, we're going to stay in the homes of individuals. Well, Paul, as he headed out, was at the best on a donkey, maybe on foot, by boat, and it was treacherous, and it just wasn't anything like we have today. And when he gets to the city, he doesn't meet friendly people. He's meeting possibly people that are totally against him in the same place that he used to be some time ago. And they're already there waiting. And in addition to that, maybe the pagan people that don't like him. You're talking about day after day living, never knowing when the next day might just end everything. I've been crucified. Sacrifice. Number two, conviction that Paul has. This is where he's at, and this is where he plans to be. It's not that he's made it because he's fallen into the hands of individuals, but he makes this choice because of what he believes in. He makes this choice because as the way he's looking at it, there's no other choice that can be had. For Paul, it's I have to. I am a debtor, is what he writes in Romans. I feel like I have to do this. Nobody compelling him in a sense other than the love of Christ that he describes that compels him. So the commitment or the conviction rather he has, and then the determination that he has. The life that I now live, I live by faith. Well, yeah, because, and I remember studying a history of missions years ago. And it took from day one with Paul's journeys all the way through of just different records of different religious groups and all this stuff about just missions all over the world. And then it came down to the early 1800s when the church was sending out missionaries. I'll mention one. Her name was Sarah Andrews. And she went to Japan. And Sarah Andrews was there during some hostile times. But because of the love that she had in teaching children and starting that school, and the Japanese people appreciating it, they put her in a protected camp so no one would harm her. But there were times that Sarah Andrews, in order to survive, ate corn stalks. She didn't go with a promise of support. She went with Christ in her heart. Dedication. And I think about all of those things that early missionaries went through. And here's Paul talking about what he did. And he didn't go the way we go today. He didn't go with a promise of this and a support of that and money in a bank. He just went. And we have some early members that did that. And it's with confidence, too, that I think he speaks this. Because of what he believes he has before him, he can now do those things. Again, the passage, I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but it's Christ who lives through me or in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Such a worthy phrase in the ways of death. Another passage, Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 and 27, really on down to 29. As Paul is writing this letter, and he's talking now to brethren, he says, for you're all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. Who all are sons of God through faith in Christ? How many people, who are you talking about? He tells you in the next verse, for as many as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Now, there are two things you can see in here. Number one, it is a doctrinal position that you by faith become a son of God when you make that next step. It's not just the faith, but those who made that acceptance and faith also put on Christ, were baptized into Christ. For as many as were baptized into Christ, put on Christ. So there's a doctrinal thing in there about faith and baptism being important in order to make us a son of God. But there's also this being, I guess is a good way of who he is and what he means, because this is a choice that he made as an individual. For you all, as he's talking, I think about himself too, are now sons of God through faith. For as many as you who made this commitment or have put on Christ. It's a decision that you make. It's not just some accidental thing where one day you said, well, you know, I believe I'll just go down and visit this religious group over here. It was a choice. It was a straightforward choice that not only Paul made, as we just talked about here a minute ago, but these people here of pagan background, they chose something different. They didn't grow up in a culture where Christianity had this large, convenient umbrella live in, morals pretty much the same, and everybody believed generally the same thing, kind of here and there, different or whatever. But if you chose this, you are radically rejecting your background, your paganism, or your Jewish background, whichever the case might have been in this letter here. Paul is addressing both backgrounds for these people. But you're no longer this anyway. You are now a son of God. Such a different lifestyle because you have put on Christ. It's not just some little easy thing to do, but it's a whole change that's taking place by what Christ did and by a choice that you make. So it's not pressed on us. And it's not like, I know some people believe that, you're either in because God wants you there, or you're out and there's nothing you can do to get in. You're predetermined, is the phrase they might use, or the word, in where you're going to be. You either got it or you don't. You either get heaven or you don't. There's not anything you can do about it. Well, I don't believe that from what I'm reading just here and many other places. It's a choice. As many people as chose to do it this way. And that choice was a very conscious choice. I'm leaving something here. All the background and all the stuff that I used to do, no more. There's a change that has to take place. And there's going to be a cost involved. Now, it doesn't explain it right here, but if you stop and think about who these people were and where they came from, you know that Paul understands that, and they understand that. You made that choice. Such an impressive thing. Incredible blessing. That was the last part here, as he talks about the next couple verses here. He says, there's neither Jew nor Greek, nor there's slave or free. He's talking about basically the two kinds of people back in those days. You're either Jew or not Jew. Greek, in other words. There's such a conglomeration of different people in the United States, and I don't know how you really radically draw one from the other, but it basically says, you're all the same. Doesn't matter who you are, bond or free, male or female, doesn't matter. You are all one in Christ. And here's where the blessing comes in the next part here. He says, and if you're Christ, then you are, strange way of putting this, Abraham's seed. He's going back to inheritance now, is what he's dealing with. And in case you're from the pagan background and don't really connect to Abraham, he'll point it out to you. You're Abraham's seed, heirs according to the promise that Abraham got. 2,000 years before this is being written, there was a guy named Abraham that got a promise from God described in Genesis chapter 12, from your seed I will bless all nations. And now God's pulling it together. He never fails, by the way, on any of his promises. And this is kind of what Paul is bringing up here. We're heirs. So something God did, a choice that we made, and a blessing we received. Really neat in there. Galatians chapter 5. We'll look at verses 16 to 25. I would give the word direction at the top of this. Paul says, I say then, walk. Walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Christianity is not stagnant, number one. Christianity is not sitting in a pew and singing songs and listening to a lesson and maybe even taking notes, as some of our young people are doing tonight. Christianity is more than that, and they know that. And this is what Paul's talking about here. It's a walk. It's a step-by-step process. Some days it's tough, and some days you're excited, and some days you're not. It's a walk, just like we go places and do things. It is action involved. And he says, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Every one of us have temptations. We all have our struggles, our weaknesses. If we will put forth the effort to make the walk that God asked us to walk, the walk in the Spirit, what the Scriptures are pointing out here, then it's a little harder for Satan to stop us. If we'll sit stagnant, he will come after you even harder. Now, that doesn't mean he won't come after you when you're trying fervently either. But I think that little scientific phrase of body in motion tends to stay in motion really goes well a long way. Is you got something going right and you're walking in it, it's easier to keep walking in it than you stop and start dragging. It's a whole lot harder to crank up. Not saying that you can't, and not saying that we shouldn't help others that should, but that's just something going on. So he gives a challenge here. There's something to do. Walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Or, now he draws a distinction here between one side and the other. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. Paul understood what it's like. That Indian proverb, probably a lot of you read, so about the chief or whoever is talking to his son, and he says, there's two wolves fighting inside you, a good one and a bad one. And the boy says, which one wins, Father? He says, the one you feed. We have the Spirit inside that's telling us what we ought to be doing, and we have the flesh inside that says that. You get that. You get angry, or you get mad, or you get lust. You just do what you want. And it's constant battle back and forth. And the exhortation is, be careful which one you feed, because it will grow. The Spirit lusts against the flesh. It's envious. It wants its habitation all its own. Verse 18, but if you're led by the Spirit, you'll not be under the law. It doesn't mean that we don't have a law to live by, but especially not that Old Testament law that he's battling about here in the book of Galatians. Now, the works of the flesh are evident, obvious. We look around and we see that. They are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambition, dissensions, heresies. Take a breath and read on. Envy, murders, drunkenness, revileries, and the like. In case there's one in there that you're thinking of, yeah, it's everything that's wrapped up in what our world gets sucked up into. And such like. Of which I tell you beforehand, just as I told you in times past, that those who practice such things will maybe, now it says will not, inherit the kingdom of God. Different lifestyle. But the fruit of the Spirit, the other side, is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And against such, There is no law. Not against that. That's all the things that God's wanting us to be. He doesn't use the word fruits. He uses the word in verse 22, the fruit. It's the product of who we are. It just creates something different within us. And then he closes out by saying this, verse 24 and 25, and those who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and its desires. And if we live in the Spirit, again, come back to that same word, let us also walk in the Spirit. It's a change of life, a change of direction, because of a distinct difference. The psalmist gives us a little bit of somewhat the same. When he says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, Psalm 1. He's not walking this way with the godly people, nor stands in the way of the sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight, this is where he likes to be, this is where he gets excited. His delight is in the law of the Lord. So different than the other side. His delight's in the law of the Lord, and in that law he meditates day and night. And he's maybe not just sitting there reading it constantly. But whatever he's doing, it's always coming through his mind. It's that filter mechanism where everything runs through here. He's examining the world. He's examining relationships. He's examining life. He's examining people. He's examining his heart by which he's been taking in on these passages. Challenging himself and reminding himself of who he ought to be. His delight's in the law of the Lord, and in that thing he meditates day and night. He's not going to be like these other guys. He's going to be like the tree. The psalmist goes on. Strong, mighty, rooted. It's planted by the streams of water, which in its season produces. And then he switches back over. He says, now the ungodly, not like that, not so. They're like the chaff. Chaff can kill you. You know that? The little husks of the corn, that little lightweight stuff. I live with a guy in Indiana who has a huge corn farm, I guess you'd say. Giant vats. And he was doing some stuff one day and he was talking about getting the corn. I said, I'd like to go in there and see. He said, oh, you can't go in there right now. He said, you'll die in there. He said, that chaff is just floating around. He said, people have choked to death because that stuff's just floating around in there in the air. Right after they poured in, they have to let it all settle for a while. Well, that chaff. He said, we're like the chaff. Just out there, it's gone. It just blows wherever. And like if you got a few feathers and, you know, somebody sneezes at the table over there, it's just they go everywhere. He says, that's kind of the way we are in life if we don't have God. One sneeze and it's just in every direction. The ungodly are not so. They're like the chaff, which the wind just drives away. What a difference, Paul says. He talks about this direction. The fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace. Patience or long-suffering, a term used here, kindness and goodness and faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Seven good qualities that represent who we are as Christians. One other passage to look at tonight, and we'll talk about some others maybe another time, but chapter 6, verses 1 and 2, and then chapter 1, verse 5, talking about burdens and things that we do in life. Brethren, I think he's coming back now as he uses that word. Let's just talk about who we are, brethren, he says. Apostle Paul sometimes will write, he'll say, little children. Of course, he was an older guy when he was writing this, and he was an apostle. Paul's an apostle, but he says, let's just get down to brass tacks. We're family people here. Let's talk about this. Brethren, if a man is overtaken in a trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself also, lest you be tempted. Anybody in here not spiritual? I think not. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands either way, but in some form or another, we look at ourselves as being spiritual. Not just because we come back on Sunday night, but because we feel like we need to be doing God's will in a lot of different ways. And this is just a small representation. You do things differently than you feel like doing because you're spiritually minded. Now, Paul adds an extra little step in here for a lot of us that's difficult here. But he says, brethren, if a man is overtaken in a trespass, here's what you spiritual people have as a responsibility. You're spiritual. Restore such a one. the effort, the goal is not to judge. The goal is not to contend. The goal is not to harp on. The goal is to restore, to get that person back. We have, at any given time, in our assembly, people that probably need that, and we don't even know it. Just need some encouragement, maybe. But out of the assembly, people are there that need to be here, and we don't know what's happening. But as Christians, you know some of these people. You don't know why they're not here, and we're not really set out to point our finger at them and say, you're up to something because you're not here, but rather it's a sign there's something not going right. Sign that something's happening inside their life. It could be that Satan has got a hold on them, sin-wise. It could be that they've just been so beaten down, they've got not enough strength even mustered up to get back to church. And they're wondering, well, when I walk back in the door, what are they going to say? And our duty as a Christian, and what Paul says as being spiritual people, is to try to help them get through that. Something's happening. All we know is they're not here. And all we know at that point is, what can I do to help? Not an indictment of something's wrong, we're going to figure you out and do something to you, but rather, what can I do to help? I'm looking to build you up, restore you. All of us that are spiritual do that. And then he throws another verse in here, kind of along with it, but it's more personal for us. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. It goes along with what's happening, because a lot of times something's happening in someone's life, and they need some support. They just need, a lot of times, someone to listen. Someone who's patient, someone who's loving, someone who's kind. And y'all do that, and do it well. On the other side of the coin, however, each one of us have responsibilities. So verse 5, he says, for each one shall bear his own load, or his own burden. Now, there's two different words that are described in the Greek between the first burden that you're talking about that somebody has and you're helping them, and the second one, which is our responsibility. One's a load, the other one's an overload. And it's drawn out in the Greek even more so. Because sometimes we just have our little pickup truck loads that we've got to carry with us and different difficulties and what have you. And then sometimes Satan just backs up a whole dump truck and just dumps it. And you just got to help somebody get out. Uncover, get them started again. So both of our responsibilities, you see, we have jobs to do as individuals. And part of that is to help people that get the whole dump truck that week or that month to restore. Now there's some other things that will go on another time here, verses 6, 7, 8, and 9, just some little stepping stones along the way. But Paul, again, coming back to this, he's writing a letter. God says, Paul, write this down. Send this to the people at Central. I want them to listen to what I've got to say, because this is important for their survival and the church to make it. We've got to hold on to one another. We have strength to do. There's a conviction for doing it. Galatians 2:20. I've been crucified with Christ. There's a battle out there against Satan. We're walking one way, and Satan's trying to get us to walk another. Galatians 5. Walk according to the Spirit. And then there's a duty that we have for each other and to ourselves to make sure that we make it together. Central does such a fine job. We just keep going through these texts and reading these things and reminding ourselves not to give up. That's one of the passages we'll come to at another time here. Because we're making a difference. Keep at it. God strengthen us to do it and do it well. will be the lighthouse in this downtown area that God wants us to be. And we'll grow and become a church that God wants us to be, even more of what we are now. That's our job. That's yours. As we close the lesson out tonight, if you need prayer, feeling weak, caught in a sin, or never been baptized, we're here to help resolve, take care of, and encourage you in whatever way you need. If you can come forward, you need to do it while we stand and sing.